Hello students, today we will learn about stereochemistry of the diol-salyl reaction. So we know that they are highly stereospecific in nature. So when we have a cis substrate, that is a cis dienophile, is always going to give rise to the cis product, and the trans dienophile will give rise to the trans product. So here we can take this example of how there are these two groups are the cis to the double bond, and you can see that both are above the plane. And in the second example, we can see the COOCH3 is in the opposite, that is that they are trans to the double bond, and you can see one is in the dash and one is in the wedge. So this is, they are highly stereospecific in nature. Now one more aspect that we should remember is talking about the stereochemistry of the reactant. So in reactant, if we have a reactant in this way, okay, there are two hydrogens, right, and there are two R groups. So these two hydrogens are, we can call them as outside group of the diol, and the R groups can be called as inside group of the diol. So now, and this is an example for cis diol, because if when you take the double bond as the standard, and you can see that R and the CH2 is cis, and again this way also you're considering there is R and the CH2, again there are cis, so that's why cis diol. And we, if you take this example, again the H and R, they are called as the outside group of diol, H and R, and here we have R and H as the inside group of the diol. So here also H and R becomes the outside and RH becomes inside, and this is an example for the cis trans diol, because we have the R, which is, you can have, see the R and CH2 which are on the same set of double bond, whereas in this other end you can see R and CH2 are the, they're trans to the double bond. So hence it is a cis trans diol. Now one more thing, aspect which we should remember here, is that all the outside groups are always below the plane and inside groups are above the plane. So whenever such examples are given, then the outside groups will always be up below the plane, that is we are going to write it in the dashed line, and the inside group will be above the plane, and we're going to represent it in the wedge form. So let us see some examples for this. So here is one example, first one. It is again example for cis diol, because you can see that R and CH2 are on the same side, and again here R and CH2 are on the same side. So hence it is an example for cis diol. And we have another dienophile here. So this is, we know that diol-salyl reaction is also a pericyclic reaction. It's happening, the product is formed in a concerted manner. So now talking about the stereochemistry of hydrogen, you can see that hydrogens are outside of the diol, right? And so hence outside are always below the plane. That's why they are written as dotted. Sorry, dashed, okay? So we are writing it as dashed. And talking about the R groups, they are below, they're inside groups, right? They're inside groups of the diol, and inside groups are always above the plane. That's why we represent it as the dashed line, and hence we are writing it in the dashed line means which represent the above the plane. So this is one stereochemistry factor which we should remember every time whenever you're there asking to write down the product, including the stereochemistry. So all the outside group will always be below the plane, and all the inside group will always be above the plane. So there's one more example like this, so which is going to give rise to a bicyclic product. Now there's some more examples. So this is an example for trans diol. So here we can see that the pH and the CH2, they are trans to the double bond. Similarly, the pH, which is at the para position, and the CH2 are again, they're trans to the double bond. So hence it is an example for trans diol. Now talking about the stereochemistry of the product, so again this is a diol-salyl reaction which is going to be giving a concerted reaction. Now the pH, the two pH are outside, so the outside groups are always below the plane. Below the plane, we are writing it as in the dashed form. You can see here it is written in the dashed form, and the hydrogens are inside group, and hydrogens are inside group means they are above the plane, and hence we are writing it in the dashed, sorry, in the wedge form. Okay, the hydrogens are inside group, hence we are writing it in wedge form, and the pH are outside the diol, and hence we are writing them below the plane. So this is the main understanding of how to write the stereochemistry of diol-salyl reaction. There's similarly one more example. Here also you can see how the H and R is outside, and we are outside group R below the plane. Below the plane, we are always representing it as in the dash form. So here you can see the dashed, and here also you can see the dashed. And the R and H, that is the inside groups will also will be above the plane, and that is what we are representing here. R is in the wedge form, and here we have H as the wedge form. So this should be hydrogen. Okay, this should be hydrogen. So hydrogen is again in the wedge form. So this is how we write down the stereochemistry for diels halide reaction. Now coming to the stereochemistry for bridgehead carbons. So now here, for the bridgehead carbons, the main group that we should understand is the endoselectivity and exoselectivity. So how do we define whether an orientation is endo or whether the orientation is exo? So always we have to look at this point, which is called as the cavity. Okay, so this is the cavity. And so if there is, and we have the bridgehead carbon at this point, right? So we have the bridgehead carbon and we have the cavity. Now, if the R group, that is the substituent, is facing below, okay, or it is facing towards the cavity, then such kind of orientation is what we call as endo. Okay, so this is one way of explaining endo. That is, there is the cavity here at the bridgehead carbon. Okay, so there's a cavity, and where the R group is being substituted, okay, if they are on the same side, or you can say that if R group is facing towards the cavity, then we call that orientation as endo. Another way of explaining is, if the R group is on the opposite side of the bridgehead carbon, so we can see this is the bridgehead carbon and the R group is trans to the bridgehead carbon, right? They're trans to each other. So even in such case, we can call this orientation as the endo orientation. Now coming to the exo orientation, so again we have the cavity here and we have the bridgehead carbon. So now if the substituent, that is the R here, is facing away from the cavity, then we call that orientation as exo. Or another way of explaining exo orientation is, we have the bridgehead carbon, and if the R group is facing towards the bridgehead carbon, okay, or we can say that if they are cis to each other, the bridgehead carbon and the R group are towards each other, that is the cis form, then we can call them as the exo orientation. So this is one way how you can write down the endoselectivity and exoselectivity for diels halide reaction. And one more very important point to be noted is that exo is very stable compared to endo for steric reason, because in exo we can see that the R group is facing away from the cavity, okay, and hence it becomes more stable when you're comparing it with respect to steric, because here the carbon is it is having a steric hindrance, and if we expect an R group to be facing towards the cavity, there could be more repulsion, which will not be feasible for the product formation. So hence exo is more favorable or more stable than endo. And here you can see that in endo there are R groups which are bulkier groups, and there is a cavity, and there could be a lot of repulsion, a lot of steric hindrance. So that is why exo is always considered to be very, very stable. However, if there are double bond in the R group, for example, if there is an ester like COOCH3, then what happens is there could be the change of the stability, that endo will be more stable than exo. So for that, that rule is what we call as the endo rule. So an endo rule can be explained in this way, that if the substituent has pi bond in its electron withdrawing group, these endo product is more stable than the expected exo product. So this is an example. So we have the methyl propionate and we have 1,3-pentadiene. So here you can see that the R group, so this is a 4+2 cyclohydration reaction. Right, so it is going to be in a very cyclic fashion. The reaction is going to happen in a cyclic fashion. So this will be transferred to here, double bond, to form a double bond. That's what is being written here. So this is a cyclic reaction, and it is a considered reaction, a pericyclic reaction, which is going to give rise to a bridgehead or a bicyclic compound. So here you can see that the R group is nothing but the C COOCH3. COOCH3 is the R group. Now we can see that this ester always is having a ketone group in that. That is a C double bond O, which is having the double bond here. So whenever there are double bonds in an electron withdrawing group, then always endo will be more stable than exo. So this is the understanding how the endo rule can alter the change, or how it can change the product or change the stability. So if whenever there is a double bond for in the R group, then always the endo will be more stable compared to the exo product. So this again based on the conjugation within itself. Okay, so this is the understanding for the stereochemistry of the diol-salder reaction. Thank you very much, sir.